Good morning and good afternoon, depending on wherever you at, the time is recording. This is episode 150 of the Restricted Zone podcast, man. So however you're listening to this podcast, whether you watched it on YouTube or you're streaming it on Apple, Spotify, or, you know, Google Podcasts, we're out there. Check us out. Leave us a like, comment, and subscribe. You can share and support if you're going to, you know, stream the episodes. We just appreciate the support. It gets us out there. And we just love recording this content and, you know, these episodes for you guys day in and day out. So, man, jumping into this, man, we still March Madness. It isn't over yet, man. We got to the Sweet 16. We got a Sweet 16 set up. But before we dive into the Sweet 16 matchups, we got to do a little recap of some of the games over the weekend, which I thought were really dynamic. I mean, man, March Madness has got to be the most fun sports event ever, in my opinion. Like, it's just so interesting because it's really based on luck and matchup, so anything can happen. So it's just filled with, you know, you just don't know. It's just a lot of unknown variables. But Kyrie, I want to start with you, man. I mean, let's talk about, in your opinion, what was probably the best game, in your opinion, or at least some of the games you really thought was really interesting and entertaining? And it just defined March Madness for you.
There was a few matchups I found really entertaining. I didn't get to watch the game in its entirety, but that Houston and Texas A&M game, yo.
Houston, like, Texas A&M. When he hit that three, I got up from my chair like, oh, my God, he really hit that.
At the end, bro, with a lot of clutch. There was a lot of clutch baskets. It was like Houston was running away with it for a second. Wade Taylor finally got it going. If Wade Taylor had it going in the first half, bro.
He was like, awful.
He was. But if you watched him in the tournament, like in the first game and prior in conference play, he was killing it.
He was. He kicked ass.
All the shots he was taking from the parking lot and stuff like that, he was knocking them down, bro. And him and the other bull, Manny Obaseki.
Oh.
Scouts weren't looking at him before, they better be looking at him right now. Because to me.
Radford, too, man. And Radford.
Radford, too. But it was something about Obaseki, the way he was able to string baskets along, the way he was always looking for a shot. He remained aggressive. He got to the rim. He had outside jump shot. Yo, if NBA, like I said, if NBA scouts are looking at him right now, bro, I mean, weren't looking at him before, they gotta be looking at him right now. But the Houston, yo, I gotta tip my hats off to them because Houston's been what we've known for them to be all season long. Yeah, and that's a gritty, like grimy, like scrappy type of team. Jamal Shad, one of the best players in the country, showed it then. He was getting to the rack 6'1", 6'2", getting to the rim at ease. He had this one little hot step, bro, that caught me by surprise. You don't see like two pro hops like into the lane like that off of 2 feet and then finishing in the lane from guards like that no more. That's kind of worked his way out of the game as the Euro step has come in. And for him, like, just to be that energizer and to get guys involved to make timely shots, it was really nice to see that to come from Houston. So that was one of the main matchups I was looking at and that it caught my eye. Cause like I said, I had Texas A&M. I didn't have them going like as Houston because I know what type of team that is. Right. We'll talk about like the Elite Eight and stuff like that later, but I didn't have them knocking off Houston, but I knew they were going to be a tough team to handle, and they definitely showed that. So shout out to them. But another game that really I was paying attention to a lot was Kansas to Gonzaga, which we were talking about a little bit beforehand. I just want to get your guys' opinion on that because Kansas was a team that I feel like a lot of people had Final Four, Elite Eight type vibe. And them losing Kevin McCuller, their either second or first leading like scorer or the shooting guard that could shoot from the outside and get to the rim, use that length. He was out, and you could tell in that second half when Gonzaga really started to get it going. Kansas struggled to put buckets together. Guys like DeJuan Harris, KJ Adams, just shows.
DeJuan Harris. I just got a real annoyance with him because he went crazy against us the first game of the season. Like, he was shooting otherworldly. He's never shot like that again the rest of the year.
He's not a scorer, though. That's the thing, bro. He's really, like, one of them, like those heady, like, flow general type of point guards that's going to get everybody involved. So I wanted to get your opinion on that real quick. How bad did you think they missed Kevin McCuller? And do you think they would have topped Gonzaga if they actually had him, if he was in the lineup healthy?
Well, Johnny, the floor is yours. I'm going to leave that question to you, and I'll follow up after.
All right. Hello, world. This is Johnny tapping in. Just an analyst, guys, not an advocate. And this is, I'm telling you, bro, it was a lot to analyze. I actually picked Kansas to win last time. Me and Collins last episode, I picked Kansas to win, even though they had their best player out. And I did, bro. But at the end of the day, it's like, the Zags, bro, they don't seem to – They like them, and maybe what other team was that won the games that they were supposed to win? Maybe Illinois that past weekend. North Carolina. I remember it was the weekend before that, when every team, when like the upsets were going on, like the weekend before, like the games before leading up to this past weekend, when all the upsets were happening, it looked like only Illinois and the Zags, the only two teams that handle business. They coming into this past weekend, the Zags just keep on rolling. And towards that game, Kansas made a run. I actually thought they were going to, go ahead and push it and be in a position to steal it. But I don't know. I think they were just missing their best player. I seen a lot of stagnant offense at the end. They struggled to string together shots and the Zags, but they just shoot better. Honestly, to answer it, I think if the Kansas was fully healthy, yeah, I think I picked them to beat Gonzaga. I felt like they matched up with them pretty well if they were fully healthy.
I had Gonzaga beating Kansas. Because I feel like Mark Few is never really – well, putting aside the fact Kevin McCullough was going to be out, that was really the main reason why. Yeah. Because I didn't feel like –
too hurt.
Yeah, yeah. And then it's like, you know, Mark Few, credit to him. Like, I just saw a stat. He's made the Sweet 16 9 times or at least 8 times, whether or not – you know, fact check that, you know, whether or not I'm wrong. But I'm like, he's really turned Gonzaga – into a powerhouse. Like, he's really had. If you look at what he's done the past couple of years, I mean, no, he hasn't won a championship, but he's made the two national championships. Has he, Kyrie, or was it just one?
It was two. He made one with the bonus, then he made one.
And one with, yeah, with Suggs. Yeah, he made it with Suggs. Yep. So, I mean, he's a phenomenal coach. And, you know, I just feel like he's turned Gonzaga to a powerhouse. So, I never count out Mark Few in a tournament at all, regardless of the conference. They always never give him credit because they say he's weak and, you know, the competition is stacking up to the SEC or ACC. But I always say he's never really truly disappointed in the tournament. I mean, besides, I guess his standard would be not making a Final Four at this point because he's just constantly.
Yeah, he's not winning a championship.
Right, exactly. Because
everything but win a championship so far.
Everything is. And he, you know, he's really turned that program around. So I never could fully doubt Gonzaga at all because they got a history of where they have shown.
Yeah, I was
about
to say, they've always been historically up there in the tournament.
Yeah, yeah.
Gonzaga's always been top tier team.
No, so and, I never want to underestimate them. Go ahead.
And this is another thing I really like about the Zags, too. They're a team that compiled of a lot of veterans and a lot of guys that have been around the block, like Ryan Nembhard, younger brother of Andrew Nembhard, who used to play Gonzaga. Who's now
killing it for the Pacers right now, too, man. Yeah. Shout out to him.
But his brother came to Gonzaga from Crete. I believe it was Crete. And he was very good there, too. But
He's
brought a lot of those same, a lot of that same, those same things that Andrew brought. He had 12 dimes the other day.
Is he playing himself into like an NBA pick? Does he have any NBA buzz?
Could be. I think if he still keeps playing well, I think if he keeps showing that floor generalship and that ability to take care of the ball and get guys involved, like he's been showing some. I think he could thrust himself in there.
Okay.
But to give credit to the other guy, Anton Watson shot 8 for 11. He was out there killing it, backdoor cuts, stuff like that. Ben Gregg had it going early on, and these are older guys. These are guys, Nolan Hickman. These are guys that have been on the squad for a couple of years. And I know that one hurt you, Collins, because at first, Nolan Hickman wasn't looking crazy. He wasn't looking that good. It took him some time to really get adapted. But since he's been adapted, he's been a nice shot maker. He gets guys involved, and he's clutch. Like, he's been really clutch for this team. And I know that hurts you, him being a former Kentucky commit. But these are the older guys. Like I'm saying, all in all, these are the older guys that they're kind of sticking to that true, like, foundation of college basketball, great college basketball teams that we've seen in the past before this whole transfer portal and NIL era. I had to give a shout out to the Jags, man. But the jumps you had North Carolina, Michigan State game?
7-1 in the season, too.
North Carolina? No, I watched NC State versus Oakland, and boy.
Yo, NC State's been killing it, bro.
Can I just say I'm a fan of NC State now? I'm like really starting to become a fan of them.
As a program, they was just dead in the water.
I know. Yeah.
Crazy.
Yeah. I'm like really starting to be a fan. Like the players are likable to me when I watch them, the interaction on the floor, and you got someone like DJ Burns, and you know, overall, I mean, the coach was on the hot seat. Like I think he was 14-17 going into this. And then it's like he punched his way to Sweet 16. They extended his contract, gave him extra 2 years. I mean, hey, that's what March Madness is. It'll crush you, but it'll give you opportunities you couldn't even imagine.
Yo, let me ask you something. Has DJ Burns so far been the hardest big man to guard in college basketball outside of Zach Edey?
I was about to say Zach O'Neal just got – he just got a nickname.
Shaquille O'Neal, you saw that, dude.
He got a new nickname from Chelsea other than that. Yeah, we ain't going to be other than him. Yeah.
And Shaq gave him that nickname. The Shaq Big Dog gave him that nickname. I'm about to say other than him. We going to roll with it. I will say DJ Burns is – he's so interesting to watch because you look at someone his size. Why does he remind me of the Grizzly player they had released, actually, Kyrie, if you know who I'm talking about. There you go. But for some reason – go ahead, Kyrie. What you about to say?
I was going to say that's definitely a fair comparison. And we've been seeing, like, this Debo comparison thrown out there, too, just his ability to stay active around the rim. Can't jump worth a damn. But he's a mountain of a man, so he's hard to box out. He's hard to get around.
But he's so nimble. It's like
his footwork's pretty good.
Footwork is phenomenal. Yeah, age, if you watch how he's playing. Yeah. No, DJ is what, a junior or he's a sophomore?
That's why I like the tournament, like bro. Put me on it.
He a senior right now.
Yeah.
Oh man.
If you're a senior.
Oh, mm-hmm. Fifth year senior, that makes sense. But he definitely he's nimble though, regardless. He's skilled, real skilled player.
He uses his body well. He uses
he sure does.
Soft touch around the rim. Like, bro, his little left hand, like.
Yes! And he'll. It was contested one time. Like, hand to hand was matching up. I thought it was a foul, and he made it over. I was like, how do you stop that? You look at coaches and say, what do you do?
In the ACC tournament, he played us. He played Syracuse. He put our Tony Hawk to sleep, bro. Like he was.
Yeah, I ain't gonna lie. He did y'all dirty.
But yeah, like, that was to be fair, that's a lot of.
I watched that game.
That was a lot of ACC teams this year. ACC teams just throughout this tournament so far.
Alabama's the only SEC team. No, Tennessee.
Yeah, the only one Tennessee. ACC team lost so far. I think everybody.
That's crazy. They're making us look like
the 9 games. I think only one ACC team lost.
No, that's crazy. I think the SEC is not overrated, but I just think it was. It just comes down to lucky and
ACC matchups. Might people be underrated. Don't... SEC might be overrated. That's what we're learning from this tournament.
It's matchups and luck.
As a part of the ACC, they kind of fit that bill as being underrated.
They do.
I didn't expect them to play the way they was faking Baylor the other day, last night, yo.
Don't you mention that. Yo, I was shocked. They destroyed my parlay. I got every other game right for Moneyline. Clemson and Baylor. I picked Baylor, and it was the only mistake I made. I said, are you still?
No, I wasn't
and they got down early.
Those are make you cry. You had some tears in your eye, Johnny. Yeah,
but
okay.
Clemson, bro, what are they doing in the Sweet 16?
Hey, man.
Like
that's the tournament. That's why we love the tournament. It's madness. Yeah.
I'm glad you can accept that. See, I'm glad you, because that's what I was telling you.
No,
bro.
But I still don't accept the loss, but we're not going to talk about that. That was unacceptable. Just unacceptable.
No, I was telling, don't jump in the grave just yet. A lot of heartbreakers. It was a few upsets this year.
Nah, I don't want to
look at Colorado and Florida.
I don't
want to
hear
that.
But Florida had them going far, bro. But they lost.
I had Florida
handlocked. I forgot. I don't know how to say it. Like my handlocked or something. Like that.
Well, listen, Clayton.
And during that Colorado game, it was a game up until Eddie Lampkin at like 6'9", 6'10", 260 plus started getting in the middle of that lane, and they couldn't do nothing about it. He was just too big, bro. He was too much.
Florida losing pained me because it was like I really had him going far. So I mean, my back
they had such a good team.
I mean, my bracket was, all four of my brackets was busted right after Kentucky lost. So it was just like, at that point, I stopped caring. But, you know, I'm just a fan of March Madness.
Kentucky lost.
South Carolina.
Don't even get me started, bro.
Listen, South Carolina lost to Oregon. I'm trying to give him other heartbreakers to let him.
No. South Carolina losing to Oregon is not unjust. Oregon's a very.
That's not supposed to happen.
When it comes to. No. Because you're underestimating them. When it comes. When it comes to tournament time, Oregon never, they always had, they have a good rep in NCAA tournament. They're not really, like, if anyone underestimated Oregon going to that, then you wasn't paying attention to Oregon.
Well, I tell you what.
Because there's a lot of people that picked Oregon.
No, you know what? I did pick them for Creighton. I did pick them for the upset. I picked them for Creighton.
Because, like, Oregon's a good basketball team. You know what I mean?
But.
Yeah, no.
Creighton's got a team that's built the goat the goat part.
What is it about? I might be underestimating Creighton. No cap. I might be underestimating
Creighton. Creighton got that transfer. What was his name? Kyrie Baylor?
Sireman.
Sireman. Yeah. And he's lights out from the three. He's kind of
Because I was looking at Baylor from the one before that. The tournament started. Like, looking at Creighton, like, before the tournament started, they had a big loss to San Diego State, which kind of, like, messed up their momentum. Yeah. And they were at the end of the day, they did end the season 7-1. So they were one of the hot teams going into the tournament. So I will say it was justified. And plus, on top of that, after handling a sweet team like Akron, you get a rhythm. You come into this upcoming weekend.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I can see it a little
bit. Momentum building.
And they are battle-tested. They played. They played Alabama this year. They played UConn. They played Marquette.
Wait, this was the last year.
They dropped 80 plus against all those teams. I guess I should give Creighton a little bit more respect.
No, that's fair. Wasn't this the last year of the Pac-12, Kyrie? This is no more Pac-12. Yeah, that's the last year. So they're all going to the Big 12 now, or they're going to scatter around? How is that? They're just scattered around.
Yeah, he was 18 points per game. I forgot about that young boy, Shimmerman. 18 points per game.
He's not a young boy. He a junior.
Yeah, he's a little older. And their center, Kalkbrenner, he had a good March Madness last year too. A lot of people were forgetting. That's when they had Nembhard and Arthur Kaluma, I believe. And they had a pretty good March Madness run last
year. Excuse me, he's a senior. He's a senior.
At 7-2, he's going to give a lot of big men problems, bro, down the line when they play Tennessee. I'm kind of jumping ahead here, but
we about to lead into that.
Yeah, we're about to lead into that.
Any other standouts? That's pretty much it. Other than that,
Tennessee Texas game was good.
Good call.
And Dolan Connect didn't even play well. He hit some clutch free throws down the line, though.
Yeah.
What'd you say, Johnny?
Yeah. I got to give it to Connect. Can I just say, bruh, I'm waiting for, I'm pretty much waiting for Purdue and Tennessee. I'm waiting for that. I don't want to jump ahead. I want to say real quick, I hate Texas. I hate you, Texas. Like, as an Eagles fan, as just a Philly fan, and just they destroyed my ticket. I bet again. So I had Texas losing to Colorado State to even get, to even make it there.
Oh, no, you bugging. Yeah,
that's OD. That's OD.
They were ranked.
I ain't gonna lie.
Texas was 7.
Colorado State is nothing about Texas.
Plus my ticket to get there. So I will say, instead of underestimating Creighton, I might have really. I was bugging for that.
Yeah.
Colorado State couldn't beat Texas.
Negative.
Oh, my God.
Texas, to me, has not shown me anything for me to confidently say.
And I don't think Texas is good.
When
it comes to down to playing comp, I don't think Texas is good. But when they came to Colorado State, bro, you had to come on.
All right, well, they ain't winning this one.
I do want to give Tennessee some love here, though, because during that game, like you said, Kyle, Dalton Connect didn't have the best shooting game.
He did.
What I liked was he impacted the game around the rim and as a cutter.
That's the most important thing.
Mm-hmm. He still found a way to get his bucket. And we got to give a shout-out to their point guards, the Kai Ziegler, bro.
I hate the little dude, because when he plays it, he goes crazy. But I love him outside of that, I love him.
He's straight up hooper. And what you love about him, he's everything you want a point guard to be. He knows situations. He knows to get the ball out of the shot.
Pesky defender.
He had 5 or 6 turnovers, I think, last game. but he still takes care of the ball throughout the season. He shoots well from outside. He just always makes the right plays, always at the right spot at the right time. And that fed into their big men, Idu and Jordan.
They need him. They're gonna need Vescovy too. They desperately need him.
Vescovy hasn't been playing well at all, though.
They need him though. If they're gonna go far, I really believe between him and Josiah, they're like the X factors for their team. But because when you
gonna be on Dalton.
Because that
they play comp, all the attention goes right to him, bro.
That's he reconstructed their whole offense. I think Kinect was absolutely when you could get a guy like him, you grab him, you don't even hesitate, but he definitely heard it everyone else's, you know, besides the Kai Ziegler, but he heard it a lot of the games. So they need him to get into that momentum, to get into that rhythm. It's because Tennessee, there's only one team, in all honesty, and we'll get to that later, who I think could, you know, like, because Purdue, between UConn
who can
and
look
Purdue.
Out of eye. Who can really look Tennessee out of eye?
Yeah.
I think Creighton might be their match, yo.
Creighton, you think so?
I think Creighton might be their match.
They're big enough.
They're bigger than them. Creighton sees a lot of threes and gets a lot of second chance opportunities. Mm-hmm. And at certain points, I've seen that killing them with Texas. Like when Texas stopped turning the ball over and they started getting into the offense and they was getting rebounds and stuff like it looked like they started to creep back in the game a little bit just from the little chippies that extra grit to go get the ball and that hustle. So. But from a team like Creighton, bro, that just plays the right way and that just always seems like their guys are in sync and their guys is always doing the right thing.
It's a system. That's what it is, bro.
They a system ass team. Like
at least they have a system.
They also got Mike Miller's son on there too. He was a highly touted freshman coming in there too. He didn't play good last game, but he's like another like low key type of X factor that if he pop off, he could have a good game from the outside. Like it could be,
oh, make them. Oh, not again. Tennessee gonna cry. You got me nervous.
You know, I just realized, Kyrie, the four teams that we absolutely dominated in the regular season, they're in the Sweet 16 right now. Alabama,
take it as respect.
Tennessee. Mm-hmm. Yo, this is outrageous. North Carolina. Oh my God, we dominated these guys in the regular season. This is outrageous.
Like lost against us too. They was never supposed to lose to us.
Hey, see, listen,
that was over something.
Outrageous. Those Oakland four lost. Teams, we whipped.
Oakland lost. You happy now? They lost.
We whipped them.
State took care of them, right?
We whipped them, Kyrie. We whipped them. Cool, sitting there watching them.
Look, Oakland sitting next to y'all. They lost now. You were going to troll that team.
Oakland didn't even get a chance to become a Cinderella. Look at it that way.
No.
If they would have beat y'all and then won again.
You know what? We're going to talk about that game, NC State and Oakland. When I watch, it's not like NC State played it wasn't like they played absolute lockdown defense on Oakland. But the defense they played was like, oh my God, this is all they had to do. Like Jack Goldie down the line.
You said they weren't shooting like that again. You called it. They're not shooting like that again.
Jack Goldie down the line when they needed him to hit clutch shots, he wasn't hitting them. And I'm like, it killed me each time he missed his shot. Cause I'm saying, this should have been us. We should be doing this.
And but Kyle,
it was just, I ain't gonna lie. It was painful.
That would have been, oh my God, are you serious?
After like his 6-3 again, y'all still didn't step up on him.
I know. That, outrageous.
I said that, bro. Oh. I said,
nobody.
After his 6-3 pointer, you got, but Colin did say the coaching didn't adjust. I said that, according to Chef, the players adjusted. Didn't adjust.
No. Thank you, Kyrie.
Shut it down.
Hey, yo, we know they're playing basketball at the park, yo. Somebody got it going, dog. And they like,
you how many times you play ball, Johnny? You play pickup. You play pickup all the time.
Really?
You really?
Six, three.
He don't get no jump shots. Kyrie, what absolutely destroyed you.
The thing is that killed me was he looking for. And I said, bro, once you're hot, you're hot. After his third one, he said, I might have something here.
By his sixth one,
I said it was not bad closeouts. Him coming off those off-ball screens, y'all closeouts was there. Y'all were very athletic.
No, was it? It was four threes. Out of those,
he was just numb. But at
some of them were contested.
It was muscle memory.
Some of them were contested. But yeah, bro, it was four open threes, tilted shots. No, like, it was four open threes.
At that point, you know.
Kyrie, why are you justifying Coach Cal? I don't like this. Why are you really trying to defend this guy, bro? I'm over it.
Well, I ain't gonna lie. Shouldn't have said what he said. The player shouldn't have said what he said in the interview and said, we're not the ones out there playing. The coach ain't the one out there playing defense. We're the ones out there not closing out.
And that's fair. That's fair. But when you watch the adjustments NC State
made, those are some crazy shots. Great shots.
No, I don't want to hear that. Those are some great shots. NC State played Oakland how we were supposed to play them. Yeah. That was what was painful about watching that game. It was disgusting. It was entertaining, but I was disgusted. Kyrie, and another thing too, before we go on to the next topic, you know what he, you know DJ Wagner, I always said was the worst point guard recruit we had since Isaiah Briscoe. Like, that's facts. I don't even think that's a debate. That's awful. And I hate talking like that because he's, I'm sure he's a great kid, phenomenal young man, everything like that. We're talking strictly on the court. He's awful. My thing is, you had two lottery picks off the bench. And I said this, it got to a certain point where it was like, you couldn't even justify DJ starting anymore because they were just outplaying him by like miles away. So it's like,
and you know what was confusing too? Bradshaw was a part of that big recruiting class for you, but when he wasn't,
we had the worst big man ever. It was 3 7-footers. We got out rebounded. How? Make it make sense.
I'm agreeing with you in the sense where you're talking about DJ, where he was still put in that spotlight when it was shown that Reed
and Rob was way better, it wasn't even a comparison.
But I'm wondering how come Cal didn't carry it the same way he carried it with Bradshaw when Bradshaw wasn't playing good.
And look, he even admitted it in his final radio. Well, not final radio, because tomorrow we're going to know whether or not Cal gets fired from Kentucky. Tomorrow is when we know. We'll get the official public announcement. So, but he said in his radio show, and I said this in the last episode, I said, promises were made behind the scenes. He because DJ was not a starting, he wasn't. He should have been coming off the bench. And then Cal even admitted it, oh, I didn't want to take DJ and Justin Edwards out because I was afraid it would hurt their confidence and whoop-de-woo. Man, they're supposed to be motivated and more hungry to reclaim that. If that's enough to break them, they're not built for. What do you think the NBA is like then?
And with Edwards, it kind of worked for Edwards too because he was getting benched.
I'm not gonna lie to you. It got to a point with Edwards where it was like, should he even be in the rotation anymore? Because he was dead bad.
But then he caught his spark. He started fitting in well.
He did, but DJ never. I mean, granted, he got hurt and he was out for 4 weeks, so that absolutely played a part. But even before the injury where he was still listed as a first rounder in the 20s, he still wasn't better than Reed and Rob. So it was like, you know, it's just one of those things, man. And it hurt the team. It hurt the team. And we got upset it again to a guy, Jack Goldie, all respect to him. He got like 10,000, 20,000 followers after he kicked our ass. So shout out to him. Yeah, that's tough. That's what Mark Man is to do. He got a bunch of NIL. I saw one. He got a Buffalo wings. He's getting these NIL. Hey, I love it. That's what Mark Man is about.
So he's going to have a hell of a story to tell you at the accounting firm.
Hey, he'll
he's still, what you mean? He's still going to be cooking down at LA Fitness Saturday and Sunday. Anybody
and you know what, with? Kyrie? You hit it right on the
car. That's what cooking them old man dad leagues.
That's what drives me crazy.
He's going to be cooking them leagues.
Kyrie, this man is going to be working.
Already. He got the old head jumper already.
Yo, he's going to be working at some corporation in a few months, and we got guys who are about to be professional players.
He said this already.
What is this?
He said this. Come and on. He could be right. playing intramural basketball, three-time MVP.
Let's get to the next topic, man. I'm disgusting. Yeah, probably have a heart attack and blood vessel and all type of nonsensical health issues. All right, let's talk about predictions, man. It's a lot of stuff going on, and I'm super excited for this Thursday. I mean, are you guys excited? Because I'm itching for it to be Thursday already.
I've been watching the games at work last week, bro.
I'm waiting. Come on, man. I just want to blink and just get
my parlays dependent on it. How am I going to pay rent this week?
Because you going in?
No, didn't come back at it. I got my picks right here.
You going in? No, all right. I was about to say the new Quillies thing. Let me stop, man. Let me stop, bro. All right. UConn, we're going to start it off. UConn versus San Diego State. The number one seed, UConn versus the number five, San Diego State. I mean, Kyrie, I'm going to start with you. What you thinking? Is it madness time?
I don't see what upset happening here.
Hey, San Diego State, they made a championship, you know?
They was in the Final Four last year, too.
Right. Let's not count them out.
That boy Tramell.
Kawhi Leonard's back.
Donovan
Clingan and them, yo, Stephon Castle.
He had 10 blocks.
Wild. Right. Yeah.
Donovan. He's shooting himself up the boards. I say that much. Like, he's shooting himself up the boards.
Hell yeah. Definitely going to be higher than Edie.
He should be. If he's not, we got some problems. All right. Johnny, UConn. All right, Kyrie.
I got what I said. UConn.
Oh, UConn. That's that's what you're rocking. All right,
absolutely.
Then. Number two, Iowa State versus number three, Illinois. Who are you rocking with, Kyrie?
I think it's going to be a fun game. I don't really know Iowa State that much.
It's like, going to be a fun game.
I've seen them beat Houston in the conference tourney. That was I think Illinois got it, though. Coleman Hawkins, Terrence Shannon. Johnny, you called it, bro.
With him, he cut Johnny called it.
I've been paying attention more closely, dog. And since he came back from his little suspension, his whole situation.
Mm-hmm.
But Ryan, bro, he's been absolutely cooking. And I don't think between Domas and Coleman Hawkins, bro, I don't think Iowa State's gonna have enough for them. I got to go with Illinois.
Yes, sir. And I got to second that. Illinois will be paying my rent as well. Because they will be contributing to my rent. They all going on my tickets. But at the same time, bro, I felt the most comfortable watching them so far throughout this tournament. Like, out of the Big Ten, they was the only team, maybe them and Michigan State before they lost, but they was the only team that was really handling business that wasn't really, like, they had the matchups. Of course, you had your little upsets, but Illinois, they just basically, they've been running through it. Like, two for two so far, they've been running through the tourney. They seem like they ain't been having problems. They seem more gel together. They've been challenged. It hasn't been, when I watched that game, it hasn't been like, oh, this could be up and down. They've been securing my peace of mind. I say they continue to do so then.
Okay. All right. So right now, inside the Elite Eight is UConn and Illinois. Is that what we're saying right now?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to be in the Elite Eight. All right.
Mm-hmm. But that's going to be a game.
What'd you say?
So that's going to be a game.
That's going to be a game. All right. That's what we say. All right. Listen. Now, mm-hmm. I personally love this matchup I'm about to say. Number one, North Carolina versus number four, Alabama. Mark Sears versus R.J. Davis. Give me that. I want that. Give me that
matchup. There's going to be a lot of buckets.
I want it.
High scoring, definitely bet the over.
Especially Alabama. They're very high off. Like, they're high offensive.
Nelson from Alabama, too. When he get high, he can.
Grant, listen, he hasn't had the season everyone thought he would have, but. He's definitely.
I'm leaning towards Bama unless
you're going to Bama. Ooh. You know what? I'm so indecisive on this, Kyrie. I'm not gonna lie to you because it's gonna come down to guard play. You think they will?
I'll score.
It's gonna come down to guard play, man. It's gonna be who's got the better hand, who's not as cold as the other defense. Who's the better defender? They both don't play defense, so I guess they're gonna be trading buckets. Maybe it changes up.
Yeah.
Who you got?
I'm gonna go get. I'm me personally. I'm gonna get an edge to UNC. I think between RJ Davis and they gonna keep feeding Baycott. And me, I'm not a fan of Baycott, but like for college basketball, like he's a dominant big man. Like I can't take that away from him. When shit starts to hit the fans for UNC, that's who they look to low key, and that's who they start running their offense through and trying to run their offense around to get him open and to get him easy buckets down low. I think this is going to be too overwhelming. Along with Harrison Ingram and the freshman, he's been coming off the bench. I think he's been starting. He hits a lot of threes. He's very athletic. He gets out in transition and defends well. I think UNC is going to edge it out over Alabama. It's going to be a good game, like you said, between Sears and RJ Davis, though. It's going to be a lot of buckets in the game.
All right, listen, I'm looking forward to it. Listen, North Carolina punched their ticket in to Elite Eight. This is the RGP Elite Eight so far. So, Arizona versus Clemson. Number 2 Arizona versus number 6 Clemson. This point, you can't underestimate. Listen, any team that makes the Sweet 16, you can't underestimate, regardless of the seed. You just can't. But I like Arizona's team more. I think they got enough guys that could, you know, even if one guy gets stagnated, they got a couple of offensive pieces they could go to. Kylan Boswell, one of the most steadiest guards. Like, I've been paying attention to him since a junior. Like, he's a steady
guy. He got to step it up a little bit, though. He was ass last game.
He was, but
that's my guy. I fuck with him, but
but I'm still high on him because he's a steady guard. Even though he was ass, he was steady.
What do you have against Long Beach State? Because they beat him by 20. Did he need to do much?
They didn't need him to do much. It was kind of more like he could have played better. But you know what's crazy? He's one of the youngest. He's 18.
Yeah.
He reclassified like as a 17-year-old in Arizona and redshirted for a whole year. He's really young, but he plays like a vet. So Caleb Love, you know what he can do. Clutch guy. He's not afraid of big moments. He'll give it to you. Johnson, the transfer they picked up in San Diego State, who's been probably the best addition they could have hoped for.
Johnson, he's nice.
Like, he is, bro, is he clutch for them. Like, defensively, oh, man.
He's like they Tyson Chandler, bro, as far as them, like, he plays alive, getting rebounds, backdoor live.
He's only like 6'7", 6'6". So it's like, man, he's tough, gritty guy. He's going to get after it. The guy you need on your team, you want on your team. And for that, I'm going to say Arizona. He just got the more deep team. Well, I don't want to say deep team, but they got the more guys, you know, they're proven, battle-tested, especially Caleb Love. I mean, he ended one of the greatest coaches' career of all time. Like, you can brag about that for the rest of your life. So, I like Arizona's chances with this. I'm not going to lie.
I think I got to agree with you. I've been looking at this matchup and thinking, like, this might be, like, the biggest upset potential because Clemson has a lot of key stacks, like, a lot of key players.
Yeah,
and just from what we've seen, like these past two games, and them against New Mexico, first of all, I know y'all talked about it, but I expected them to spank New Mexico like that. With Jamal Mashburn Jr. and Jalen House, they were looking really good coming into the tournament, and I thought they could have made a run, but the way they shut them up, the way they beat Baylor, bro, they got a lot of spunk and a lot of edge to them as to where I could definitely see them upset in Arizona. But you know what it is for me, y'all? And call me biased, call it color, whatever it is. But Joe Girard, their starting point guard with Syracuse, the starting point guard for the past 4 years up until this past season.
Right.
And I've seen him shoot teams out of so many games.
Not advocating, you just analyzing. Right, Kyrie?
I'm
analyzing. I'm just from what I see. Hey, feel me?
Just telling the truth.
From what I've seen. And low-key was seeing him do it against Baylor towards the end of the game. But his shot selection sometimes, like his decision-making at times, I could definitely see this being a close game and him shooting you out of it.
Wow.
Turn the ball over or try to play.
Wow.
What it is with him, he tries to play hero ball. Y'all be down like five or something like that, or down four. He just comes down and jacks a three. Like,
oh,
I've seen it happen too many times. And I can't.
It's only good when you make them.
It's only good. And for us, it was here or there. It was sometimes he did, sometimes he didn't.
It's only good when you make them.
But he's still the same. Like, he's still the same player. Like, him being at Clemson not going to change none of that. Like, he's still the same player.
That's a fair observation. I mean, Johnny, I'm going to swing it to you before we get to the next one.
Yeah, I like Arizona. Clemson bust my ticket. I say that this is the wall they run into. No, I like them, though. They're scrappy. They are very scrappy. But
okay.
I like Arizona, though. Arizona is one of those top teams in their conference for a reason. They pretty much was running the Big Ten. No, I'm sorry, the Pac-12.
I mean, and their coach, Tommy Lloyd, is actually a pretty great coach, and he made the Sweet 16.
I don't think they get challenged until the Elite Eight.
So if Arizona and Carolina go as you guys, well, I think Johnny had Alabama. So I guess for Johnny, it would be Alabama versus Arizona, and Kyrie, it would be North Carolina versus Arizona. So I'm going to just keep that in mind. We're going to go talk about Elite Eight predictions, too. But we get to the next one. Number one, Houston versus number four, Duke. I'm gonna start with Johnny first, Kyrie. I'm going to start with Johnny first.
Yeah,
I'm going to switch it up.
I wonder what Johnny got to say, because this is probably the toughest one.
Because if Duke win, I'm still not calling it an upset, just because it's Duke.
No. Really?
No, it's not an upset.
I'm not calling it an upset.
Can I do a coin toss here? Because I like both teams. I like both matchups. I picked Houston to go all the way to the matching up.
You're not wrong.
Am I wrong with going for Duke for the history of Duke? Am I wrong for just saying I like Duke just because of the history?
You're not wrong for either choice.
Houston, and honestly, the way watching Houston, can I say Houston didn't almost lose, but they didn't win too convincingly their last time out. I think it was yesterday or the day before.
Versus Texas A&M,
they almost lost that joint, but I'm going to fraud Duke. Duke seemed a little bit more convincing.
I will say this. Texas A&M, they got some guys that can score. Like, when you got Wade Taylor.
Which is the bigger, I think it comes down to style. Give me Duke. Duke pays my rent.
Duke
pays my rent over Houston, and that's going to crush a lot of brackets too.
Oh my!
That's going to break a lot of brackets.
No, you got the Duke fans that are going to
Houston is people pick Houston for national champions a lot. They in the national championship game, they pick Houston. A lot of people pick Houston for that much. I got Duke beating them. I feel like Duke has been there before, just for the prestige. I think they've won their games better in this tournament so far. Who's the bigger team as far as the matchups? Who's the biggest team?
Well, technically, the number one team is, but when you're playing Duke, for some reason, Duke's just always going to be the bigger team.
And Duke fans travel, too. It might be a neutral court, but Duke fans travel, bro. It's like, it's going to feel like a home game for them, no matter where you at.
They're going to be in Dallas this week.
I mean, I'm going to say,
let me get Duke, Duke's going to pay my rent.
I don't know, Duke or whatever the kid. I don't know, but hey, they gonna be tuned in though. Kyrie, what you think, man? Just give me your thoughts.
The people watch the Strictest on podcast, bro, to hear the realness, bro, to hear like authenticity.
Authenticity.
And on my real bracket, I got Duke beating Houston.
Really?
I got Duke in my real life bracket on ESPN. I got Duke.
Is it Jared McCain? Is he what moves it for you?
You know what? It's not Jared McCain. Jamal Shedd actually might get the better of him between in their matchup, just because Jamal Shedd is a little bit more.
The experience.
It's Kyle Filipowski.
You think he's a difference maker?
I think Kyle Filipowski is going to find his way in the middle of that Houston defense into that paint and use this size, use that touch, use that fadeaway. And I think he might cook Houston's bigs, bro. I'm not even going to lie.
You think so?
Houston's tough. They rebound. They're strong interior defenders. But it's not only going to be Kyle Filipowski. Tyrese Proctor, who's been very good this season, I think steps up. Jeremy Roach is always good in tournament time. Jeremy Roach is always good at tournament time.
Jeremy, you know what? You know what? You was having me convincingly till you start naming some of these people. Now I'm like, oh no.
Like you said, McCain, Mark Mitchell, who's a good hustle player, gets key rebounds.
He's been up and down this whole season, but okay.
He's a little inconsistent. But I think
you was getting me convincingly. Now I'm 50-50 now.
I personally Kyle Filipowski leading the helm, bro. He's gonna I think he's gonna go for 30.
You think so?
I think Kyle gonna go for 30.
You taking that on FanDuel if they posted that.
I seen Kyle get hot in big games, bro. I seen him.
Okay.
And I don't want to diss Houston like that because I think they're a very safe pick. Like if you got them beating Duke and advancing to the Elite Eight Final Four, I'm really not mad at you.
Right,
but I think Duke is too overwhelming talent wise. And to be honest with you guys, Houston, like you said, Johnny, they didn't win convincingly against Texas A&M, and they let A&M make it a game. But something about that loss to Iowa State to me in the Big 12 left a bad taste in my mouth.
You smell suspect.
It's slightly suspect. Like
not okay,
the hint of suspicion.
A little bit.
Okay. This is going to come down to as Duke is the more talented team, but it's going to come down to the execution, which coach, you know, makes the plays that makes the plays down the stretch. This is going to be a close game. I don't think either or is going to blow each other out. I mean, if it does turn into that, I will be shocked, but I think Houston, it's going to come down to execution. Who executes when it comes down to it, when they need it the most. And, I like Houston's experience. Not to say Duke doesn't have experience. You got a couple sophomores. You got Jeremy Roach. He's been there for, 4 or 5 years. I just think Houston's going to tighten up because I'm pretty sure they looked over that film. Because I was surprised they let Texas A&M took them to, like, they. But it's March Madness, too.
Oh, yeah, I'm about to say so it's a tournament. It's
right. So you got to factor that in.
The guards that can score.
But Texas A&M, and that's to give them credit. You got Tyrese Radford. You got Wade Taylor, Johnson, Solomon. Like I said, Johnson. Solomon. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They got guys, though. So it's not like Texas A&M is some scrubs. They honestly, their record should have been a lot better than what it seems like. There's one of those teams, you look at their record, and you say, oh, you underestimated them. But it's like, no, they should have been a lot better. But I think they're tightening up a lot.
And that's the thing, too, though, Colin. Like, you're naming those guards that gate. Like, we've seen give Houston a hard. And Wade didn't even have a good game in the first half.
Wade was awful, honestly. He shot, he was awful.
He I think it was, like 3 minutes into the second half or something like that. He hit his first three.
Oh, yeah.
The guard play with Proctor, who could give you, like, a good 18 points a game. And Jerry McCain last game.
I'm not sold on Tyrese Proctor. I'm just not.
Jerry McCain last game. That was the second game in at least a month I've seen him go crazy and hit, like, 5 threes.
Jerry McCain, I believe in him. Not
he's
Proctor.
A bucket dribble, bro.
Proctor's been playing good. Show me. How's he been playing? He's really, I mean, this whole season together, listen, just look how his stock has pretty much fallen. He went from being a lottery to, he's like second round to the end.
He was never a lottery this year.
Yes, he was. He was a first round. He was 10 to, anywhere between 10 to 17, you saw Tyrese in the beginning of the season. You saw Tyrese Proctor's name. Kyle, and then you saw Tyrese Proctor. They was having them.
Kyle higher than Proctor.
No, Kyle was always higher than Proctor, but Proctor was in like that first round late lottery. He was in that was his projected draft range, and he's been slowly falling off because his play has just been he was hurt, but the injury. But he didn't make that jump from freshman to sophomore that you would expect when you got a year of. You know the system already. This game should be easier. Should be slowing down for you a lot more. He never took that next step. You know, he hasn't took that next step. And Jeremy Cain's honestly their best guard. Like, by far, it's not even no other guard outside of Jeremy Cain has been the most productive that season for them. I mean, Caleb Foster was in and out throughout the season. Tyrese Proctor, he's another one. Then, I want to go with Duke, but their guard play if McCain doesn't get it on, then Duke's really screwed. You got Kyle, but how much?
I just want to confirm because I didn't know if I was tweaking it up. But Parker did have 18 last game on 7-15 shooting.
No, listen, listen. I've watched him. I get it. Because tournament time,
enough buckets for you.
Right. I guess in a tournament setting, he may be more reliable because the games I've watched him in, he's just. I'm like, man, this is the guy who was saying was going to be this dad for Duke, and I'm watching him. There's nothing about him that just excites me about him. So it's the tournament time. It's a different atmosphere. So we'll see. But I feel like he's going to probably struggle because Houston guards are going to be up in there. They're going to be.
That's fair.
They're going to be playing some defense.
Who you got winning, though, Kyler?
I got Houston winning. But I wouldn't be surprised if Duke won. Not at all. But Houston should win this out. It's going to be tough, though. It's going to come down to late game execution, though. Marquette, number 2 Marquette versus number 11 NC State. So I just want to give a little recap before we dive in. So far in the Elite Eight, we have UConn, we have Illinois, right? Now we got North Carolina for Kyrie, and we got Alabama versus Arizona for Johnny. So we're going to talk about that a little bit later, too, as part of the Elite Eight. Houston versus Duke. We got Duke, Kyrie, and Johnny. Duke versus potential. We're going to get to that prediction now. So Marquette versus NC State. Kyrie, who do you think is going to win out of that matchup and head punch their way to the Elite Eight? That's another great game.
It is a great game. I got to get an edge to Marquette, though.
And
you know, Marquette ranked higher. I feel like winning this game would feel more like an upset just because of NC State's success this past month, winning 7 straight games.
I just can't ignore that fact. That fact itself is like, you can't ignore that.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a tight game, too. I think Horn and Burns is going to give them a good run for their money. But Tyler Kolek is a straight-up hooper.
Yes.
And the way he can score so easily and just so efficiently around the rim with his jump shot, getting other guys involved in the pick and roll and pick and pop situations and transition. He just seems so locked in and so in tune with all his guys, and their chemistry offensively seems crazy. Like, it just looks really, really good right now. And another player that I really like is Oso Iguodaro, who's supposed to be a first round pick this upcoming year. His game's really been like very intriguing to me. He's got like a nice little post up game. He's very athletic to finish around the rim. I just think they're going to edge out NC State here. I think they play a really good brand of basketball and going to get the win here.
Okay. All right. You got Marquette. Johnny, what about you? Marquette versus NC State. What's the potential Elite Eight matchup? You're on mute, Johnny.
You're on mute.
On mute, my guy.
Y'all can hear me?
Yes, sir.
There we go. I like Marquette in this one, y'all. I'm a second in. I think they got the more talent. NC State get stopped at this one. And honestly, I'm an NC State fan, and they almost make me want to make a separate ticket just to pick them for a possible upset. But they just been having such a run. I've been a fan of them. But I like Marquette more. I like Marquette more for how they've been throughout the tournament. They've been having like some up and down stretches in their games too, but Marquette's been proven like they I think they're better defensively, and I think they're a little bit more talented, but I think they're better defensively. I think they get added more over the NC State. Yeah, bro. I like Marquette. I think they're the better team just a little bit. I'm not even looking at rankings, honestly, because NC State, they don't play like a number 11 team, but I think Marquette's got the better defense. I think they out-rebound them. I think they hold them back a little bit more. The over-under for this was like freaking 70-something. So I think I got Marquette down for holding NC State down a little bit.
Okay. All right. I have an ACC matchup. I got NC State pulling an upset on Marquette. Just got a gut feeling.
I want that to happen because I want to see them play Duke.
Just for that ACC matchup.
You're a fan of NC State. I get it. My upset team was going to be
good. No, but I just feel like
NC
State isn't necessarily at a disadvantage against Marquette. It's really a good game. It's going to be a high-scoring game. You're going to be trading buckets. Defense, they're both adequate defenders, especially Marquette. So No, this is going to be a good game. It's going to be a close game. But I think I see NC State pulls the upset over here. All right. So we go on to the last matchup of the Sweet 16. We got number one Purdue versus number five Gonzaga. Kyrie. I told you, I'm never counting out Gonzaga.
Yeah, but I'm not counting out. Yeah, me neither.
But I feel like this is Purdue because Zach Edey has been playing like Zakil. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Zakil been going crazy, man. He's been going crazy.
Yeah, but we've seen Zach go crazy and then get to March Madness and lose to like St. Peter's and whatnot, bro. It's like,
but I feel like it's different with this team. This Purdue feels different. I'm not gonna lie, because usually if it was last year, I would have agreed with you wholeheartedly. But I think this is a different Purdue.
The Purdue looks the exact same to me. That's just me personally. Okay. And the reason they look the exact same with me is because their offense is pretty much Zach Edey or die. And
no, they got some capable guys, man.
I mean, the bull Fletcher Lawyer or whatever, he can walk here and there, but it's just like they guard play don't really stick out to me like much.
Well.
Okay. I just think they're a team that's too reliant on Zach Edey, bro. Like, that's just always been Purdue's problem to me. They're too reliant on Edey. And if he's not getting free throws, if he's not getting the foul calls that he's used to getting, and the whistles going his way, it could be a really tough game for them because he's not slowing the game down. He's not getting in position. He's obviously not getting in position that he's used to getting in delivery of the ball to him. Like, it's. And I think if Zaga's got the people like Ben Gregan and other big men and Anton Watson and guys like that that can play a good zone defense and make it frustrating for him to get the ball and get comfortable.
Right.
I've seen teams do that to Edey this year, and it didn't look good. And when you see other guys try to create, other guys try to feed off of him, not really contributing offensively, and it just be looking sloppy. I don't know. Purdue's not a team that's like just that crazy to me. I just feel like they got one of the most dominant big men in basketball, and that's their offensive identity. That's just how they coast off of him. So,
okay.
I don't know. I got good.
So are you calling the upset here?
Yeah, I don't. I wouldn't even see it as much as an upset either, because I think Gonzaga is just as good as the team is though.
Okay, that's fair. That's fair. All right, Gonzaga. All right, Johnny, we got Gonzaga in the Elite Eight instead of Purdue. What do you think?
I want to see Tennessee and Purdue. I want to see a rematch.
All right, okay.
I want to see a rematch. I want to see Connect and Zach Edey. I want to see what America wants. I hope Purdue wins this game, picking them as well. The last time, man, it was a great – last year, what they went to overtime, Purdue edged them out by five as far as Tennessee was concerned. Now, Purdue does sell. They do sell in the tourney. They do have a history of, like, selling out in the tournament, I guess, so to speak. Like, when Purdue –
A few times
they were supposed to advance, supposed to win, and they ended up losing. So they don't have a good tournament history, but I think they get over that hump this time. So I will say, yeah, Kyrie, they usually be selling, but – but this is like their second one seed. I think their second time they haven't been really a one seed for too many times. But yeah. I think they finally get over the hump. They take that momentum and they go ahead against Tennessee. I want to see that matchup. You don't want to see that matchup. You want to see the Zags versus like Zach Edey versus that prestige. But you want to see one on one, like matchups, big name player on big name player.
They wouldn't be for marketing purposes.
Purdue and Tennessee is better on paper for marketing purposes.
Yeah, it was.
I want to drink that Kool-Aid so bad, man. I hope Purdue does outlast a prestigious, very mature, very built Gonzaga team. But Purdue, bro, they have to take. This is the best they've been in a couple of tournament trips. They gotta take it. They gotta get over the hump, right? And they gotta go see the next matchup.
Okay. All right, that's fair. Well, you know what? It's tough. I'm gonna go with Purdue though. I'm gonna say because.
Oh, he's going against Mark Few. He just say you don't.
I know, but this is my thing. Purdue, like Zach Edey, transformed his body. He looks a lot.
Who's their backup like, big man too? They got another big man too. That
they don't even run him. They don't even run him. Easy out there, bro. They eat or die.
He said, don't even run them. No, they do. They got Will Bird, so you know.
Yeah.
So you know they got like, a backup.
There you go. Come on, and it's March Madness.
You but listen, yeah, I feel like you underestimating their guards. They're not as bad as
Kyrie said. He said,
listen, I feel like. Because Zach, he's really having a... Zakil really having a phenomenal year, though, even by his standards.
Yo.
So it's like I got to go with Zakil, man. I got to go with Matt Painter, the coach, too. I feel like he knows what he's going to have to do. But listen, Gonzaga to me, I feel wrong for picking against him. Don't get it twisted. I feel wrong. Something's telling me I'm going to eat my words. But I'm gonna stick with my guns. I'm gonna still be wrong. If I'm wrong, so be it. I'm gonna be wrong, but I'm gonna say, bro, no, you just, I'm right.
You just switched up. Kyrie is looking at you like you, Eggs Benedict, Benedict Arnold.
Oh my God! Yeah,
yo, you. Why you your philosophy is like at the 10-minute mark in the episode.
Yeah. He said he put the philosophy at the 10-minute mark.
He said he liked him.
Listen,
he said he liked Gonzaga.
Johnny.
Advocate for me, Johnny. Advocate for me, Johnny. Advocate for me.
I gotta play plaintiff's attorney right now. He said.
He didn't.
I don't go against Mark Few and Mark Madness.
I said I don't like to go against Mark Few and Mark. Talked
about how good Gonzaga was. We talked about the seniors they had on their team. I talked about how they're always up there. They're always in the tournament. They always are a top tier franchise as far as school. We've already mentioned it.
Listen, Kyrie. I feel wrong for picking against Mark Few. I don't feel good about it. But
Purdue has
like,
never been number one. Like, and they don't get number one like this. It's for a reason.
Yes, they do.
Like, they got the momentum.
They've been number one.
They won last year.
Second time. Yeah, like, they were number one. Like, yeah.
I know.
Hey.
They
don't mention that team's name.
They get over the hump. This is when they get over the hump.
Hold on, Johnny. Don't mention St. Peter's. Let's be talking about
you can't mention Kentucky.
Don't mention that. Let's be talking about the religious figure in the Bible. Let's be talking about that. Don't talk about that team. That team disgusts me. All right, we're gonna go.
You're not wrong, see. Purdue pays rent. They pay rent this.
This is the kill in Neil's time. But shout out to Mark Few though, if you win though, you know I'm just gonna lie.
Shout out to the coach though, if you win.
Number two, Tennessee versus Creighton. That'll be the last of our Sweet 16. We'll give our Elite Eight another day. But we're gonna talk about number two, Tennessee versus Creighton. Kyrie, who are you rocking with, man?
I don't feel good with this one. I don't feel good about going.
Just to pick. I know.
Just pick him.
I gotta go with Creighton.
Yeah, he's gonna pick Creighton. You heard him. All
right. I gotta go with Creighton, bro. Okay. I really explained it. I really gave my breakdown, and I convinced myself like earlier in the episode when we were talking about the matchup, low key. And I was like, yo, if anybody's here to make a mockery of Tennessee, it's gonna be them.
You did say that.
They match up well. They do.
I'm just mad. I don't remember your minute mark.
I think they play to a lot of Tennessee's weaknesses. Like, I think I think their strengths will show up to be a lot of Tennessee's weaknesses, bro. And I think it's going to start and it's going to stem from the big man play with Ryan Kalkbrenner. Like, him being a lob threat he is, the offensive rebounder threat that he is, and able to extend plays. And they like to shoot a lot of threes, so him getting them rebounds and kicking it out to like a Tyshawn Alexander or a Baylor Shireman, I can see that breaking Tennessee's back like early in the game, bro.
Oh man,
and I don't know why. Like, it's just certain games and certain matches. Like, when I envision it, I just see things going a certain way, dog. And I honestly see Creighton busting Tennessee ass. I ain't gonna hold you.
All right, sheesh. All right, that's a strong evaluation there. Analyst Kyrie, let's swing it to Analyst Johnny.
I've been saying it before. I say it again. I'm picking Tennessee. I want to see that matchup with Purdue. However, I have mentioned it before. I am super well aware of who is coming up this next round in the tournament. I understand who Creighton is. I even said I underestimated them. They destroyed my parlay, and I understand why. Like they're fourth in the conference in rebounding. They played the tougher teams. I think they had a tougher schedule this year between Bama, UConn, and Marquette alone, and they dropped 80 plus against all three of those teams. These guys will show up. They will play according to competition in a good way, not in a bad way. The better the competition, the better they seem to play. It's been proven. We saw it this year. Listen, man, didn't they make the Elite Eight last year? I think they had Bayer Schemmerman, 6'7" guard, 18 points per game, about 9 boards, 4 assists. I understand who Creighton is. End of the season, 7-1. I understand all of that. I have to pick Tennessee. I have to pick them. They're number 2. I got to pick them. I got to see that rematch with Purdue. I have to see it. I feel like they get their get back, honestly. If not, that could be a toss-up. But I think that's just a better matchup for Purdue as far as Tennessee. I don't know how Creighton would match up with Purdue. I think Tennessee needs to beat Creighton for a better matchup. I want to see that. I want to see those two. I want to see Kinnett and Edie go at each other. But honestly,
my thing is 14. You guys made great analysis points for Creighton and why Creighton and you guys.
Yeah, I understand. And let me. So I gotta say that
should be able to be.
But it's a very conscious decision. I'm picking. I gotta pick Tennessee.
I'm looking at Kyrie. When was the last time Rick Barnes went to the Elite Eight? When was the last time he went to the? When was that?
Was it back when they had like Grant Williams and Jordan Bone in them?
Mm-mm. They never made the Elite Eight. No, wait, they did. No, they didn't. Nope. Was it when KD was there? No, KD didn't go to the Elite Eight. He lost in a. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Well,
no, KD was at So I don't think KD made it to the Sweet 16. So he hasn't made the Elite Eight since 2008.
And what team was that with?
That was Texas. Yeah. So.
DJ Augustine.
Yeah, DJ Augustine. DJ Augustine.
Oh my God.
Oh, let's go! What a name drop.
DJ Augustine for the guys for the young bulls that don't know about DJ Augustine, man, look him up. That was a real solid point guard. He played about 10 plus years in the league. Yeah,
he
for a minute. He's a solid guard, man. He was solid back.
You think he could have been better?
He should have been better. Honestly, he should have been better. I thought he could be better, but he hasn't been there since 08. So when you look at that type of history, you kind of figure out, okay, what has been the common denominator since? You haven't been there since 2008. So now it's like, is this the year? Does he make it? Is this where he breaks it? Because now I'm realizing for Rick Barnes, it's a lot at stake for him. You know, especially if you got an NBA draft lottery talent like Dalton Kinnett. I think he's going to go because of that. I think that's going to really fuel him to coach to a level. He's probably, not to say he's not a good coach. Rick Barnes is a good coach. But I feel like this game is going to hit a little bit different for him, knowing that he hasn't been to the Elite Eight since 2008. That's a lot of years. I'm not even going through the math. It's a lot of years. Yeah. I think Tennessee wins this one. But you made some great points, Kyrie. I wouldn't be surprised if Creighton won either. But I think
Rich Barnes,
I'm not mad at y'all picking Tennessee neither. I don't, even though I see Creighton whooping their ass, I could definitely see it going the other way. I can see Tennessee winning as well. I can see Kinnett getting hot and Zakai Zegar getting hot and getting guys involved too, having himself like a double double type of game like he had this past game. I can definitely see all of that happen, but
you can't look past them. All right, Tennessee can't look past Purdue just. They can't look towards Purdue just quite yet, bro. Baylor Schemmerman is. I ain't peeped Schemmerman was a 6'7" guard dropping 18 points per game this past season.
That's what I said.
That's a little bit different. He's a transfer. He ain't start with.
He's a transfer.
Huh.
A lot of transfers been turning their career. You know, a lot of transfers, but man.
Listen, We pay rent this week.
Listen.
Stay with me. Kyrie said, I'm going to go broke. Kyrie said, no, you're going to stay broke. He'll like Bama, and he'll like Tennessee. He'll like Bama or Tennessee.
Where's the powerful, Johnny? Let's not do that now. Listen, I've been saying that the Sixers are going to win the title. I guess they aren't that powerful. They haven't won the title yet.
Bama or Tennessee. Right,
but listen, let's with that to conclude episode 150 of the Restricted Zone podcast. This was our Sweet 16 predictions. We're bringing it out to you guys right after the heavy-hitting March Madness weekend. Hopefully you enjoyed this episode as much as we enjoyed recording them. Elite 8 predictions will be coming very soon, very, very soon. So be on the lookout for that. So, you know, just leave a like, comment, and subscribe. Turn on the post notifications so you can always be up to date whenever we're dropping the episode. We got something big planned for NBA draft night this year. So we'll announce that sometime a little bit later towards maybe after the lottery. So, you know, something big going for the draft night from the RZB crew. So we're ready to start it. So like I said, just thanks a lot for tuning in to us, you know, showing love and support. We see our subscribers and our likes and views go up day in and day out. So we really appreciate the love and support you guys are giving us. You can check us out on all streaming platforms, Apple, Spotify, Google Podcasts, the Instagram page at Restricted Zone Pod. The Instagram links to the RZP crew members is in the link below. So just click it. Any questions, anything you want us to talk about, we're definitely open to it. Have a great weekend, everyone. Stay tuned for the next episode.